You're listening to the only show in the galaxy for dadpreneurs who want to have it all. Each week, you'll see how you can have harmony in the four pillars of purpose: family, faith, fitness, and finances. Welcome back to another Daddy's Working podcast. All you daddies out there, love you and want to put this out there for you. Hashtag Daddy's Working Podcast. We're on IG, we're on Facebook, LinkedIn, hashtag Daddy's Working Podcast. Feedback for the episodes, you want to make fun of us or you learn something totally interesting, tag us with the hashtag Daddy's Working Podcast. All right, so yeah, my pitch for the day. Actually, it's one of the things I'm always studying how we can get better. Not just for us, not just for me and Cupcake, but for our clients over at the Podcast Factory. And I'm always looking for new ways to help our clients make a greater impact. And one of the things that I've studied up on, and I've seen this from Pat Flynn, and I've seen it from other fellas, is getting a little engagement, talking, because when you're behind the mic, it's kind of lonely back here. And you got to look for ways for you and me to communicate. I'm teaching a lesson and learning one all in one space and time here. But that's why I put the hashtag out there, Daddy's Working Podcast. See who's out there, talk to you, know that I'm not all alone behind this mic here. Anyways, what I've got for you today is more super fun. Isn't it always super fun? But it's part two of the interview with Nick Nanton. And he's got more stories than you can shake a stick at. This guy is amazing. He's got parenting tips. And I love to just get different perspectives on how folks are growing them youngins out there to see what works for us. And I really liked Nick's perspective on what he's doing and how he's helping his children to thrive, really. So in today's show, the stupid obvious difference between super successful people and those average, ordinary people living lives of despair. A sneaky question to ask your clients that will make it easier to deliver something they love. How to have your kids happily doing homework every single night without your help. All that and a whole bunch more. Let's dive into part two of the interview with Nick Nanton. So look, this was something that came up, and this I wanted to talk about a little bit because we are about family. And so I thought, man, Nick's amazing. How the hell do you make more Nicks? How do you raise your kids? What is it like with them growing up? Because we're trying to do some of the things you taught us. So I want to share it with the listeners.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, well, first of all, anyone who has kids knows this cruel joke of, first of all, you are going to have a child and you think because you are the only human being you've ever been your entire life, you just assume that another human being, like you married somebody, you have a partner, and like, okay, so it's at the very least going to be the mix, 50% them, 50% me. And you realize that, oh, wait a second, this thing is own human being. Like, that's not cool. There's supposed to be a miniature me or a miniature them or a miniature us. And then you sort of get a handle on it and you have another one. And you're like, okay, cool, I've done this. So the second one, no problem. I now understand this. My children are different. And then you have a second one that's nothing like the first one. And then you're like, this is an even crueler joke. And then on and on we go, where I have three, because I'm a quitter, I stopped. they're all three completely different. I mean, they have elements. There's certain things from like my wife's from like me. But as I try to raise them, first of all, I try to, you know, look, we all have like things that we remember as really positive in our life. We all have some trauma in our life that we remember. We all have certain things that I'm never going to do that. My parents did. I'm never going to do that as a parent. And then the funny thing is when you open your mouth and your parents come out, that definitely happens. But I realized, I think I came to a point where I realized like I was somewhat like my mom, somewhat like my dad, but as a very different person. And we all, especially after I moved out of the house, like most people, we came more to terms with that in a positive light, right? Because we all, it's tough raising kids and them having their own mind. I got a 14-year-old right now. It's a totally different world. He's like his own little human being that thinks he's responsible for himself and doesn't realize how unresponsible for himself he is. But he's being taught, like, he's got to learn that. So I just came to a point, I think a lot of it was through my faith and through people at church and stuff who taught me a couple things I thought were really profound. Number one, discipline is not supposed to be because you want your child to do something a certain way, particularly. The mindset of discipline really should be, from my faith background, is that I need to be able to share with my child that, you know, of course, that I'm doing things because they're, even though you don't like them, they're good for you. But even more importantly, I want to teach you how to be obedient to someone who's above you, so that when it's your turn, when you are in charge of your family unit, or you're no longer under my charge, that you will still be willing to submit to God. And so that you'll be willing to be obedient, because we all, look, we're human beings. I have great discussions with friends about faith all the time. They think I'm an idiot. How could you possibly believe this guy was just out of nowhere, put here, rose from the dead, all this stuff? I'm like, well, look, dude, you have faith in something. It's just something different. But the thing is that I understand your thought process. You know, we go into like, how could there be terrorism? How could there be cancer? I don't know. I really don't know. But here's the deal. I do understand that from my point of view in faith, if I want to be God in every step of every day, I want to be in control of everything. I want to be, this son is going to be super smart. This son is going to be super attractive. This one, oh, he is not going to like that girl. He's all right, whatever, right? Or this friend's not going to get sick. This friend, oh, I really think that work should start at 9:30 tomorrow, and that the bank should open at 7:15 because I want to go to the bank at 7:15. Now, right? I mean, we want to be God. We want to be in charge. We want to be in charge, and we want to have totally arbitrary rules based on our feelings and emotions. If anyone would admit that, I think faith becomes a lot easier to understand, because God is impossible to understand, because we want to be Him and we want to make all the rules instead of letting Him do it. And we don't understand the bigger picture. He's either not really there, or He's evil, or whatever. So it's just, as I realized some of these things, I started realizing, like, my goal is actually to nurture my child and give them the room to become the person, the best version of themselves that God created them to be, because they're not going to be me. And in a similar fashion, I learned a long time ago, a lot of people, I think we talked about this at lunch, that a lot of people block their day in like 15-minute increments and all that stuff. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it. But for me, I like plan like 3 or 4 things. And I have plenty of time in between when I can, because I don't know, if I plan my day, it's not going to be nearly as cool as if I just sit back and get the few things that are important to me, I think are important, out of the way, because it allows my brain to move forward and feel productive. But I just let God do what He does. If I tried to overmanage my schedule, who I would meet with, who I wouldn't meet with, who I'll take a phone call with, who I won't take a phone call with, I mean, you got to try to make the best decisions you can. I mean, if someone emails me like, you need to give me an hour of your time because you don't understand it, no, I'm not going to respond. I'm just going to delete that. But if anyone ever emails me and is like, hey, you came and spoke to my university class, where someone said, will you come? My answer, anytime you want me to come speak to a class or a podcast, or is always yes. It's just scheduling, because I don't know what's going to happen. It could be nothing, or it could be something awesome, but I'm not God. I don't know. So why don't I just take the journey? Because it's never really hurt me before. So I've taken that model to try with my kids. However, I mean, it's very, way easier to talk about in a podcast and actually do it. I mean, you know, just because there's so much involved, and you want them to be successful in school, but you want them to be well-balanced, but you want them to play sports and have activities you want. And so it's hard. I just think, to me, again, ego-wise, I think I have to just constantly try to check myself and say, is this what I want? Or is this what I want for them? Or is this what's best for them? And realizing that they are who they are. But I know a lot of people are very intentional about certain things. Yeah, I really want my kids to do this by the age of this, by the age of that. And I also, it could be very good for them. It's just not my strength, my skill set. So I just try to just think through in an intelligent way, and with my wife and with my kids. And sometimes I ask my parents, like, hey, what'd you do in this? You know, whatever. But just people around me who are smart, just try to think things through and just try to let them. My goal at the end of the day needs to be, I think everyone would say this, but it's hard to do, I just try to keep reminding myself, my goal is to help them be the best version of themselves they can be. And that is not Nick Jr. Like, that's not what's for them. I would never have guessed I'd be in the career I'm in, doing, making films around the world. I'm having a blast, but it definitely wouldn't be for everybody. And so why would I try? I don't know if any of them have any interest in it. They have interest in certain pieces. I don't have to go anywhere I don't want to between 9 and 6 every day, or, you know, I don't have to go to, you know, lunch in a cafeteria, or like, they like the freedom part, but there's certain things that just would make other people go nuts. So I got to remember that. And then again, just try to help them develop, again, to give Dan Sullivan some credit, their unique abilities. And I think surrender, I mean, it's a good term.
One of my favorite things that we talked about, and that it goes against everything everywhere, normal society. And it's one thing that Rachel and I talk about with, or Cupcake and I talk about with our son, is where you said you had the idea of, yeah, there are certain things that you have to do. There's no question. Some things have to be done. And that's that. You have a school project, you have an assignment, you have a paper due. It has to be done. But does it have to be done on their terms, or can you do it on your terms? Like, that open-minded thinking, everybody would shun that. And to me, I'm like, how do we live by that so we can get the end result, but it doesn't have to be how someone else told us to get it?
Absolutely. I mean, I think, for instance, my whole thing with my kids is like, hey, are you doing it to the best of your ability within the constraints you have? But the funny thing is, many times, like, if the teacher says, hey, I need you to write me a paper on XYZ topic on the third president of the United States. Like, okay, great. And so many times I don't know that I'm doing it all the time effectively, but I'll try to talk to one of my kids. And my oldest son seems to really, I'm sure like a lot of kids, seems to really like video, editing videos on his iPhone, stuff like that. And by the way, I make films, but I'm a terrible editor. So it's not like he got it for me. It's not my thing. So I would, if he's being miserable with the paper, let's say, I hope I have the foresight to say, hey, do you have, what's the purpose of the project? Do you know the purpose of the project? And by the way, that can frustrate a teacher, but hey, you know, I'm trying to understand the purpose of the project, because what I want to do is, you know, I really want the, I'm having this fictional conversation right now because I don't know that I've ever done it this way, but I have no problem doing it. You know, we both want him to learn, my oldest son, or any of my kids, to learn. Like, is there some sort of state guideline you have to meet? Okay, so we gotta take that into account. And I do understand you, it's probably pretty difficult to let 37 ducklings do 37 different things. I get that. So but within reason, but even if he has to turn in a certain assignment that everyone has to do, how might I inspire him with his skills and things he likes to do to actually learn something useful? And then if we have to, we can do the painful part of making it in the format the teacher needs it in. But again, just how can we capture their imagination to not, or even sometimes you just ask them, they thought it was a limitation like us. That wasn't even really a limitation. I never said you had to do it that way. I just said, some teachers like, that'd be awesome if instead of writing a 3-page paper, you made a 5-minute video, because the class might actually learn something from it. So it's just, I think it's just asking questions of how can we make this more fun and more interesting. My rule in life in general, for the most part, there are some things you have to do. I don't really love lifting heavy things. I couldn't say I love my feet pounding the pavement for 4 to 5 miles, 3-4 times a week. I've learned to embrace it. I listen to audiobooks and podcasts while I do it. But there's certain things you got to do. You can't wake up and drink whiskey from 9 a.m. Even though you really like it at like 9 p.m. maybe. There's certain things you have to do. But why don't we ask the questions within the realm of healthy things in life? How could I do this in a way that would allow me to utilize my strengths, and maybe I could utilize the strengths of others around me to make it even better? Because as we all know, I mean, life is not a series of one-man shows. It's just not. And so I try to help them just see that and see that, well, did you ask the teacher if you could do it this way? No. Well, what makes you think you can't? Well, she showed us examples from last year and everyone did this. Well, that's you're still not answering my question. Did you? And so just trying to get them to think that way, like, hey, I remember one time, this is a bad story, but it's pretty funny. I was in, like, I don't know, 7th grade typing at the time or whatever. And a teacher, not my favorite. And so I would rabble rouse every now and then, but just like talking or laughing at my friends or whatever. So I got assigned at the time to write 300 times or whatever, I will not talk in class. And so I did what any kid would do. I asked her if I could do it on my computer. And she said, no. I was like, come on, you just want me to learn to typewrite. So I eventually convinced her, let me do it on my computer. And so I just copied and pasted it 100 times. And so, but you know, it was, I did the assignment. She didn't say that the goal of the assignment was for me to sit there for 2 hours and write it over and over again, although it probably was her goal, but she never made that very clear. So her goal, stated goal, was to deliver it written however many 100 times. So I did. So, you know, just trying to think about, and again, it comes from sort of not having certain resources as a kid, or, I mean, like, you know, entrepreneurship is, I mean, there's a reason why so many people are ADHD, dyslexic, that the people who have a lot of challenges become entrepreneurs, because you learn pretty early in life that you're never going to be able to make it the way everyone else is telling you. And so you learn at some point in your life that, oh, there is another way. At some point you get fed up with whatever everyone else's other way is. And you go, I've done enough other things that they told me I had to do it a certain way, but I couldn't. And it worked out just fine. So why don't I just try that in some other areas of my life? And that ends up usually becoming entrepreneurship from my experience.
Yeah. I like the other part that you focused on there. And I think this is what separates successful people from people living plain, ordinary lives. And it was focus on the result. That's what matters. If there's a result that we have to get, sure, let's get there. I might not take your way, you might not take mine. But at the end of the day, if we're getting results, whether it's for ourselves, for our clients, for our children, isn't that all that matters, is just get the end result?
Absolutely agree. And you know, some of the lesson is in the hard way to get the result, but some is learning to never do that again or do it this way. And so for sure, it's never going to typically be easiest at first. But yeah, I think a big thing most people don't ask the question of is, I love the Dan Sullivan question. We quoted Dan a lot here, which is great. We sort of met through his network. So, you know, if we were saying, oh, I almost fell out of my chair, this must be good. if we were having a beer or a ice water or whatever it is 3 years from now, celebrating however it is we're going to celebrate 3 years from now, and we had just accomplished, we were celebrating how well this project we had done was, what would have had to happen for us to have the best celebration possible and have an awesome. So when I do that with my clients, it's such an amazing thing, because you get, all of a sudden you cut very quickly to the core of what it is they're really after. And so it's like, oh, well, yeah, I can deliver that. Now there's options for how we deliver it. Because most people come to me for, you know, a film project or a book project or whatever else. And because it's not what they do all day, every day, which is fair, which is the reason why I go to a doctor, he does all day, every day, they think that they need to do it this way. And I've learned to ask that question, like, well, what's the actual outcome that you want? And when we get to the outcome, then let me give you the different options. And let's pick the one that would make you the most excited. I have clients all the time say, hey, I have this budget to work with you this year. I love the project we did last year. I'm going to spend this much. How should I spend it? And the great news is, number one, I've built enough trust with you that you're telling me how much money it is and you ask me how to spend it. That's good. And the reason why you do that is because I've done it all. I've done all these things that I tell you you should do. So I can't change my answer that I do think at some point you should do all of them. But I will tell you to start with what makes you most excited. Because if you do something you're not excited about, it's never going to work. And whatever you're most excited about next, so even just in a PR project, if you're excited about it, you're going to talk about it all the time. And it's going to have more success for you because you're talking about it, because you're excited about it. So let's go that way. And so I just try to find what is the outcome you want, and let me present some options. And whichever one you light up at, that's probably the one you should do, because it makes you excited. And obviously we know when you're excited and dedicated and motivated by something, you're gonna have a lot better outcome than if you're apathetic about it. But like when I used to not use ghostwriters for my writing, I was a decent writer, but man, it was like pulling teeth. And so I would be down to the deadline. I'd be down to and it would just be painful. And I just realized, oh, wait a minute, there are people who do this. I can just talk to them, which is a skill I have. And they can do it. And so that'd be great. And it made my life so much easier. I became so much more prolific. One of the things that it's a really stupid lesson, but I think it'll make a lot of sense to people. You know, when I started doing interviews with people, at first I wasn't doing any pre-planning because I'm not a pre-planner. So I didn't want to have to read 8 books and write an outline. So I would just sort of wing it, because I could usually get away with starting somewhere and going, like, I could wing it, I could be fine. But then I realized, like, oh, wait a minute, there's people who, like, this is what they do. So before I started doing interviews, I started having someone spend weeks reading all their stuff, reading their blogs, watching stuff. And then what I did for them, depending on the format of what I'm going to do, but in most cases when I'm doing an interview, it's going to come out to be like an hour long to 90 minute finished piece. If it's like a portrait interview piece, like on my show on Amazon called In Case You Didn't Know. And so I literally will have my writer write an article that's all about the person and interesting parts of their life. And I'll read that. Now I just read the article 2 or 3 times. And then they give me what's called a beat sheet, which is that article broken down in questions with basically the most likely responses, because that's what they wrote the article on, was what the response would be. And so now instead of, I don't dread it at all. The night before I do an interview, I read the article and I make sure the questions are in line. And then I read the article again the next morning. And now I have a very short-term, very good look at their life, and I know some of the moments and the critical pieces. And then I do the interview. And of course, if they light up about something I had no idea about, or they take me on a tangent, we go there. But I'm not unprepared. I'm prepared. I outsourced the preparation that I never would have done before. And I have way better interviews. But it was just a simple thing of realizing, you know, where's that friction? Who can help? Because there are people who, and the people who do it, it's so funny. They like thank me for paying them to do it. They're like, ah, I never thought anyone would ever just pay me to write and read. And like, this is my favorite thing ever. I'm like, I'm so glad. I'm so glad that's your favorite thing. This is my least favorite thing ever.
Too good. Too good. So let's talk a little bit about some of the movie projects you're working on. I mean, you said you're going to Iraq. What are you working on?
So I'm working on a project with a foundation that has, I don't know how much they want me to say about it, but I'll tell you some. I would tell you everything. I never asked them how much you want me to talk about this, but basically a foundation that's rescued thousands and thousands and thousands of people from ISIS in the Middle East and religious minorities. And so we are going over there and telling some of the stories and showing some of the, you know, some of the problem over there. I mean, a lot of people thought ISIS was dead or is like dying, and they are sort of rebuilding for a resurgence. Not only that, you know, they're really trying to just smite out certain religious minorities in different parts of the Middle East. And so we're going to go try to sort of share that story, because it's not a story that's being told a lot. But when, you know, you look at Kurdistan and north of Iraq, it's the biblical city of Nineveh, whether or not you believe, you know, the supernatural part of the Bible. But if you just go through the historical context of it, I don't think anyone would say wiping out all of history in an area and building it over again from scratch is a wonderful idea. So there's just not a lot of people paying attention to that stuff because there's so much else going on in the world. And this organization chosen to focus on it. And, you know, as I've found in anything I've done, when you focus on the human aspect of anything, it becomes fascinating. And there are women and children and, you know, people being kidnapped and trafficked and all sorts of things by ISIS. And just at the beginning, one guy just decided he wanted to do something different. He thought, man, maybe I could do something. And now tens of thousands of rescued and relocated people later, you know, he's making a huge difference along with his team in the lives of people who wouldn't have an opportunity but for anything else. So I'm telling that story right now. I've done a few movies on human trafficking, one in Haiti, Operation Toussaint is what it's called. It's on Amazon. I have another one we did in Colombia called Triple Take, which was three raids that happened at the same time that, as far as we know, is the largest sex trafficking slave rescue in history. And then I'm doing a project right now, Folds of Honor. We're finishing up a documentary. It's a military support organization founded by an amazing guy named Major Dan Rooney. He's the only guy in the world who is a fighter pilot and a pro golfer. And they have given $120 million in scholarships to the families of fallen soldiers. I mean, you know, if you were to meet any soldier on the front line and said, hey, if something happens to you, what do you want me to do? To a number, every single one of them would say, take care of my family. Yeah. And so they're doing it from the bottom up, which is awesome. And we've got a bunch of other crazy stuff in the works too, but you know, it's been awesome, just because for me, just getting to interact with people who are doing different things and curious about different things, it reminds me how many good people there are out there, and it's just really fun to tell those stories.
I like that attitude that you have too. It's more of a, the world is a good place, even though you're showing all this bad stuff. You seem to have that attitude of people are good, the world is a good place, we're doing good work. And I admire that very much about you, and I hope to learn more of that, because I'm a bit of a grumpy person myself.
No, you're not.
So one of the things I wanted to just highlight here quickly, as we're coming to the close here, is that you've done a lot of work. I said it in the beginning, kind of jokingly, freed slaves, but you've also done documentaries where some of that stuff is going on here. And when I say here, I don't even just mean the US, I mean here in Orlando. And that is unfreaking believable. When you told us that, we were like, no. So I can't, I mean, you're doing good work out there, saving people everywhere. And I appreciate you for that, brother.
Thanks, man. I appreciate that. We made the two movies in Haiti and Colombia. I had never, focused on human trafficking because it's not a pleasant thing to think about. But as I learned about what was happening, and I, through conversations with the organization's Operation Underground Railroad, through conversations with Tim Ballard, the founder, when we were shooting or whatever, I was learning about all these things that were happening in America, and people would watch the movies or learn what I was doing. Like, man, most of them would say, oh man, that's just heartbreaking. That's happening there. And I realized that no one really knew what's happening right here. So we are now making a film. We'll make it. We haven't even officially announced it yet. So there you go. We can do it right here. And we, over the course of next year, we'll be making that film called It's Happening Right Here. And it's all about, you know, human trafficking in America. We're going to cover Canada. We're going to cover some of the pipeline of how a lot of young girls get smuggled in from Mexico through the US, and then just regular in every city in the country, in almost every neighborhood is happening. A lot of times the ways you think it would happen, and a ton of them the ways you wouldn't, just through blackmail of pictures or videos or whatever. And there's just such a spectrum of it. I really just want to turn it into a project where people like me who have kids, who I don't know how to talk about this stuff to my kids. They're trafficking kids right now on, of course, Facebook and Instagram, but things like Fortnite and even Roblox. And anywhere they gather these people who are professionals at grooming children and trying to trick them into doing things that they don't realize what's happening because they're being tricked by professionals. It's happening. And so I really just want to bring light to the fact that it is happening right here. And how can we, what can we do to prevent it? What does that look like? And that's a tough thing. What can we do to recognize it? Which I know a lot of people weren't even looking before. So if I could just start that. And then how, what can we do to just be able to open the conversation with our kids? It's not, you know, I think, and I think a lot about the fact that in like 80s or whatever it was, like, you know, don't talk to strangers. Actually, one of the guys I believe who I've heard this story several times and who sort of championed that, that whole movement sort of now says, man, I wish I hadn't said it that way. Cause like a lot of people would help you if you needed help. So there's good things of like, don't go with a random man who tries to give you a lollipop in a mall if you can't find your mom. Like, that's a different game. But what would it be like if instead we had focused on the right things? So what I want to focus on is, it's not like the risk of the probability of any person at any time being trafficked is, I don't know, but it can't be that high. But why don't we just the same way we tell our kid, hey, you probably shouldn't hop in the back of an ice cream truck, even if the music sounds good and they're promising you ice cream, probably not a good idea. Sexual abuse is a really, I talk to kids about, I mean, it opens so many Pandora's boxes at age appropriate levels and everything else. So I'm just digging into that, trying to figure out what's the best film that I could make that would help with those things. And as you can tell, there's a lot going on in my mind. So I don't even know what that's going to look like, but I figure trying is better than not. So that's what we're doing over the course of the next year.
Brother, this has been a pleasure. It's nicknanton.com, N-I-C-K, Nanton, N-A-N-T-O-N, to get more from Nick. Man, anything you want to say? This has been amazing, and I could keep going, except I have another interview booked, but anything else as we're wrapping up here, brother?
Oh, man, no, thanks for having me on. It's a pleasure. You know, hopefully I didn't ramble around too many things, but that's the way my mind thinks. And then, you know, if anyone wants to see more, we got a ton of stuff on all the major platforms. My sweetheart of the moment would be helpful to me. I have a call that Larry King's executive producing, a show that Larry King is executive producing called In Case You Didn't Know with Nick Nanton. It's on Amazon. There's two episodes so far. We need reviews. Of course, the more reviews we get, the more it drives up viewership and Amazon serving it up to other people. So I'd be honored if you watch anything. I'd be really honored if you watch that. I'd be super honored if you watch that and left a review. That'd be super helpful to me. And I appreciate people like you sharing so other people might find out about the stuff we're doing. And, you know, it's that's how the world works. So I appreciate you.
So it's In Case You Didn't Know on Amazon. We'll make sure to link to it in the show notes and put it out in the emails as well, brother. Thank you so, so much.
This is the PodcastFactory.com.